Thank you for joining the worship services of Shoto, Brady, and Dutton United Methodist Churches. I'm Pastor Julie King, and I'm so grateful for digital technology that allows you to join us from wherever you are in the world. You can join us every week by clicking the links on our Facebook at facebook.com/ShotoUMC or on our website at umshoto.net. If you like what we are doing and would like to financially support us in ministry, you can find more contact information on our website, and again, that's umshoto.net. We're so grateful that you are joining us.
As Robert gets ready to come forward here for the scripture reading, I have to tell you a funny story about it. He got voluntold that he was reading scripture this week. And so when I told him yesterday evening, because I kind of forgot to tell him before, I was like, oh yeah, by the way, you're reading scripture tomorrow. And he's like, what? And he said, what scripture is it? And I said, don't worry, it's just John 3:16. And he was like, okay, I can do that one. So it was a good week for him to read scripture.
I think you all know this scripture pretty well, as most people do. So, for God so far loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, for that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Huh? Oh, thanks to be God, amen. Sorry.
So this scripture, I wouldn't necessarily classify it as one of my own favorites, but it is, of course, one that I have known very, very well since I was, as really as long as I can remember. When I remember this scripture getting really popular, it was about, I think I was junior high or maybe high school age, and there was a wrestler, Stone Cold Steve Austin, that was really, really popular with John 3:16, and so it gained a lot of popularity among youth that were my age, particularly the boys who watched wrestling, and it was really cool to see young boys quoting scripture that probably never would have known the scripture. It also became a favorite of mine when I found out that I was having a little girl for the first time. When I found out I was pregnant with her, I was just sure she was going to be a boy. And I was sure I was going to be a mom of boys forever. And then I found out she was a girl, and I was so excited. So of course, I ran straight to Walmart and got paint and bows and all kinds of pink girly stuff. And I went home and I started decorating her nursery. And I went all out on it and made it as pink and frilly as it could possibly be. And then I had this one space on the wall that it needed something, and I didn't know what to put there. And at that time, it was when the vinyl expressions were really popular for the walls, and I was a stay-at-home mom who happened to be a distributor of those vinyl expressions. So I custom made one for her wall, and I used the scripture and made it say, "So for God loved Isabella that he gave his only begotten Son," and put the scripture up there on her wall. And I knew that it was something that she would wake up and she would look at it for years and years to come. And I even left it on the wall when I sold the house. I have no idea if it's still there or not, but they had a baby, and so maybe they changed the name and put their son's name. I don't really know, but I would like to think maybe they did, because it was a really great idea in my mind, and I loved that scripture being on the wall. If there's any verse that is known by a very wide audience, it is John 3:16. I wanted to really focus on this scripture this week and on the power of these words. And as I started researching it, I realized that many, many scholars argue that this is the most popular scripture around the world. It is the most popular scripture that the most people can quote word for word. And maybe they use different translations, but they still know this scripture. This scripture is also fascinating because you could argue that it summarizes and tells the whole gospel story in just one sentence. On the night that Jesus presented this simple statement, he was having a conversation with a particular Pharisee who was named Nicodemus. And so I want to backtrack a little bit on that story and tell you about what led up to this statement in the conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus. So you can imagine that the hour was probably late. It may have been very hot and dark in Jerusalem. Maybe there was a warm wind blowing through. And on those dark streets that night, there was a man. He's winding through the streets with a torch in his hand, and he probably had a very particular purpose in his step. He arrives at a house, and it's the house that he thinks that Jesus is staying in. And so he knocks on the door because the last several days had raised many questions for him. Nicodemus carries the doubts and fears through that door to see if Jesus really held the answers. See, Nicodemus had saw John at the Jordan, and he had heard the rumors about the sky opening as Jesus entered the water. He also knew that that marketplace was full of whispers about these miraculous acts and events that were challenging the very traditional Jewish teachings. Nicodemus's world seemed a little bit upside down because of this man, this rabbi, who was this very unique person claiming to be the Son of God. You can get the picture. If we think about John 3:16 in context, I think that we can see that Nicodemus comes with a little bit of faith. But he also comes with a lot of very big questions. And so he begins asking Jesus these questions, and then Jesus gives him an answer, which makes him ask even more questions. The first question that Nicodemus asks isn't really a question in itself, but a statement that has a very implied question. And he says, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher and come from God. For there's no one else that can do these signs unless God is with them." We might think of this in different wording, thinking, you know, Jesus, this man, he has to be from God, because how else would he possibly be able to do these miraculous, out-of-this-world things? Or we could think of Nicodemus' statement in asking, "Rabbi, why do you perform these miracles? It must be because you come from God, because I can't figure out any other way that you would do it." Throughout the conversation that Nicodemus and Jesus have, Jesus uses similar words three different times. He says, "I tell you the truth," or "Truly, truly, I tell you." And so on this occasion, this first response to Nicodemus's questions, this is how Jesus answers. He says, "I tell you the truth, that no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." When Jesus says the kingdom of God, what exactly does he mean? That phrase, kingdom of God, is used 67 times in the New Testament alone. And if you use kingdom of heaven, Matthew uses kingdom of heaven 31 times just in Matthew's gospel alone. So it's a very important theological point. And we as Methodists have a couple understandings of the kingdom of God. We know that the kingdom of God is physically a place. We call it heaven. We believe in heaven. We believe in that amazing kingdom that is there. And then we believe that we can catch glimpses of what it might be through very miraculous moments here on this earth. And I think in this response, when Jesus is talking, he's talking about the physical place, heaven, the kingdom of God. But as he says that, remember he said you have to be born again. And so Nicodemus looks at Jesus and says, how can a man be born again when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? It's a legitimate question. But if we take it at face value, I think everyone who is a mom in here or anyone who has ever watched their spouse give birth would really hope that that is not physically possible to be able to climb into your mother's womb and be reborn again. Jesus obviously had a very different point that he was making here. And so this is how Jesus responds to him. He says, I tell you the truth. Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you that you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. As I read this and I hear what Jesus is saying, it's a good reminder that you don't always take the Bible literally. Obviously, we're not going to completely go through the birthing physical process again. But what Jesus is saying here is that we are not fully going to understand where the Spirit blows from. The Spirit is going to blow into our life. It's going to touch our hearts. We are going to feel it. And when we do, we are not going to question where it comes from, but we will believe. If you are thinking right now, how can these things be? How can the Spirit work like this? Well, then you are actually quoting the scripture yourself, because that's exactly the next question that Nicodemus asked Jesus. He says, how can this be? A scholar that I was reading the work of earlier this week said that the answer to how can this be in Nicodemus's mind was that these things could not be. In Nicodemus's mind, this particular scholar said that he most likely thought that, like the devil and the angels, our paths would lead to destruction without any alternative. The angels that fell from heaven weren't made in the image of God. They weren't human. But there's a big but here. We are human, and we are the Imago Dei. We are made in the image of God, and we are God bearers. And because God loves us, he sent his son. And so Jesus responds to Nicodemus, and he says this way. He says, how can you understand when you haven't accepted what I've been teaching and doing all along the way? Jesus challenges Nicodemus here. He says, the reason that you don't understand why these things can be is because you don't believe in me. You've heard, you've seen, but you do not believe. You've listened to the words, but you don't believe them. And so Jesus knows at this point in time that something miraculous is about to happen in Nicodemus's life. It's like he's saying, hold on, Nick, there's more to your story. Just bear with me. Keep going. And Jesus answers him this way. He says, so I tell you the truth. For God loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. So why is this one statement, this one scripture, so important to so many people? I think that there are some really big things that happen in this scripture. As I said, this scripture can pretty much summarize the entire story of the gospel all in one. It tells us first that God so loved. We know if we read other scriptures that God is love, and God so loved. And because God loved, the whole entire world is the next part of the scripture. We are reminded that the world is Isabella, like I changed the scripture to be on her wall. We are reminded that the scripture is me, that it is you, that it is every person in this world. We are reminded from this scripture that God loved and he loved everyone on this world, that he gave his only begotten son. Of course, we can read through the rest of the scriptures in the New Testament. There's prophecies from the Old Testament that point to the Messiah coming. And we can learn about Jesus and that Jesus was sent to save every single one of us. The scripture is so important because it's saying God loved and he loved every person that he created so much that he sent Jesus to die for their sins as a sacrifice. And then it closes, of course, with whoever believes will not perish, but they will have everlasting life. That is, of course, the biggest promise. That is why we believe in God as much as we do. That promise of heaven and the kingdom of God that is so perfect. A place where there is absolutely nothing but love. And so this scripture, to me, I think touches the lives of so many people around the world because it is an easy way for people to know the promise and to proclaim the promise. And it doesn't matter if they are black, it doesn't matter if they are white, it doesn't matter if they're a male or a female, if they're red or yellow, it doesn't matter if they're rich or if they're poor, it doesn't matter if they're straight or if they're gay. It doesn't matter if they are a liar or a cheater, a backbiter or a gossiper, or even a murderer. God created every single human being on this earth, and he did it in his image, and he loves them. And as long as they love and proclaim that they believe in Christ and are truly born again through the Spirit, then they will not perish, and they will have everlasting life. You know, it's interesting to me. I meet a lot of people, a whole lot of people, and I have more conversations with people about little things like this that remind me of Nicodemus than I do really deep conversations. If we look around in our church building every Sunday, there's not a lot of us here compared to the number of people that we interact with outside of church. And when I'm out in the public, wherever I am, people, of course, as soon as they know that I'm a pastor, tell me, well, I do believe in God. I do, but I don't go to church. I pray and I believe, but I don't go to church. And I think that they do it because for whatever reason, they have been hurt by the church, or maybe something just doesn't fit with them. Maybe they don't feel comfortable. Maybe because they feel like they've messed up too much. Maybe they just don't prioritize it or make time. I don't really have all those answers, but what I do have is conversations similar to that of Nicodemus and Jesus. I have somebody that comes to me with a little sliver of faith and a whole lot of questions. And then we begin to have very deep conversations about what their relationship with Christ looks like and how much God loves them. And what that promise is, that they have to believe, and it has to be a deep, true, personal belief. And if they do, then they are forgiven, and they too are promised eternal life. As we begin to transition into our hymn of reflection, I wanted to bring up kind of an interesting history of this hymn. We're going to be singing Thy Word is a Lamp. And some of you might be very familiar with this song. It's actually in our hymnal. But there's an interesting backstory to this song. This song was written by Amy Grant and Michael W. Smith. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with their names. Amy Grant and Michael W. Smith ended up putting together the first Christian album that ever reached the Billboard charts in the United States. That was in the mid-80s. At the time that this particular song was written, Michael W. Smith, who was really the songwriter, took Psalm 119 and he put a tune to it. And it's the Thy Word is a lamp to my feet and the light unto my path that we'll sing here in just a moment, and most of you are probably familiar. He showed Amy the demo and sang what he had wrote for her, and he said she loved it. And he said, but I don't understand the scripture enough to write the verses. And so if you like this, I want you to take it and I want you to roll with it and I want you to write the verses. And Amy said, yeah, I'm feeling this, I can do this. And so at the time that that conversation was happening, they were on Caribou Ranch, which is located in Colorado. And it's a huge recording studio. It's, I think it said 8,000 acres is how big the ranch is. So it's a very large property, but it's high up in the Rocky Mountains. And it was evening, and Amy was headed back to her cabin, and she got lost. And even though they don't have grizzlies there, they do have mountain lions, and they do have black bears. And high up in the Rocky Mountains at night is not a place that somebody is, especially somebody that's unfamiliar with it, wants to find themselves in the middle of the night. And she looked out, and she saw a lamp that was on in a cabin in the distance. And so she knew somebody was going to be there, or it was at least going to be a place for shelter. So she headed directly towards that light, and she kept following it. When she got there, it happened to be her own cabin, and she had no idea. So she went inside, and she sat down with a pen and paper, and she wrote the words to the verses that we will be singing. The song was published then in 1984 and became very, very, very popular, not just in the U.S., but around the world. And it is actually published in our United Methodist hymnal. And I knew I had to look this up in Brady as we were singing it, because I got to thinking, I was like, our hymnal was published in the late 80s. And so I had to look and see exactly what year. The copyright of our hymnal is 89. And so for this song to have been released in 84, and then I'm sure that work was already happening on our hymnal before it was actually published. It's pretty amazing that this song made it in there. So just neat little tidbit of information. As I've thought about this song and we go through these lyrics, I really hope that you will use it as a hymn of reflection, understanding the ways that the scriptures lead and guide us. My hope is that each one of us might be like Amy, and that we are able to find Christ as our light anytime that we are feeling lost or afraid or scared, that we will see the light and that we will go toward it. Or maybe some of us might feel like Nicodemus. And if we do, I hope that we will ask questions and that we will hold on to that little shred of faith that we have. And out of those big questions that we have, our eyes will be opened amazingly. And that our relationship with Christ will be understood on such a deeper level. And if maybe we're not relating to Nicodemus or Amy, I hope that maybe we're feeling a little Christ-like. So that each one of us are available to be the example of Christ in this world. So that we can help others to understand that God created you and me and this world, and that he gave his only begotten Son so that everyone who believes in him shall not perish but will have everlasting life. Amen. At this time, I would invite all of you to join me in singing Thy Word is a Lamp.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. To my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.